Hey guys, Professor Dave here. I know you're probably having a hard time with your SN2, SN1, E2, and E1 mechanisms, especially deciding which one is going to happen. Well, don't worry, I'm here. I'm going to give you some basic tips that will help you decide.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So when we're learning these first few mechanisms, a very common substrate is the simple haloalkane. So we want to understand that the differing substitutions that are possible, or degrees of substitutions of each haloalkane, are going to tell us which mechanisms can or cannot happen. So for example, if we look at this tertiary haloalkane, we have to understand that SN2 is not going to be possible because there is simply too much steric hindrance for a nucleophile to approach that tertiary center. So steric hindrance means there's a lot of alkyl groups, that's a lot of electron density that is going to repel any incoming nucleophile that is negatively charged. So with a tertiary haloalkane, we can rule out SN2. That's not going to occur. However, SN1 is a very good candidate because we know that the more substituted that a carbocation is, the more stable it is due to the hyperconjugation from the neighboring alkyl groups. So if this bromine were to leave, it would leave a tertiary carbocation, which is stable, so SN1 is a very good candidate. Therefore, E1 is also a good candidate, and E2 is also possible. So basically, with tertiary, we know no SN2. With a primary haloalkane, SN2 now is very possible. There's not very much steric hindrance. It's going to be very possible for a nucleophile to approach this carbon in this direction. And so SN2 is going to be possible. E2 is also possible. However, SN1 and E1 are very unlikely to happen because if this bromine is to leave, that would leave a primary carbocation. A primary carbocation is very unstable because it does not get to enjoy very much hyperconjugation from neighboring alkyl groups. So because a primary carbocation is very unlikely to form, we can more or less rule out E1 and SN1 for a primary haloalkane. There are some exceptions like an allylic system, but at this stage we can pretty much just take it for granted that a primary carbocation is very unlikely to form. With a secondary haloalkane, there's not that much information that we can get. If there's a lot of beta branching or some steric hindrance more towards the sides, that might be a factor in repelling a nucleophile that's going to do SN2. But basically, with a secondary haloalkane, we can't really gather that much information about what mechanism is going to occur just by looking at the substrate. But for tertiary and primary, we are able to rule out some possibilities. The next thing we want to look at is the strength of the nucleophile and leaving group. So the first thing we want to understand is that nucleophilicity parallels basicity. This means that there's a correlation between how much a group is able to coordinate to a proton and how well a group is able to coordinate to a molecule. So something that's a very strong base seeks to form a bond to a proton, but it could just as well act as a nucleophile and coordinate to a molecule. So, for example, hydroxide is a much stronger base than water, right? It has a formal negative charge. It's a strong base. A water molecule is not very basic. In fact, it's neutral. So that means that if, let's say we keep it real simple and we're just trying to decide between SN1 and SN2, we'll take a look at the eliminations later. If we look at this substrate and we look at what would happen whether hydroxide or water were to attack, now the hydroxide is a very strong base, so it's a very strong nucleophile, so it is capable of an SN2 reaction. So there's the SN2 product. However, a water molecule is not strong enough to do SN2. It's not a strong nucleophile. So, but what could happen is that if the bromine leaves, leaving a carbocation intermediate, that is a very unstable situation. So a water molecule would be a strong enough nucleophile to coordinate to a carbocation and then deprotonate. Basically, a water molecule is capable of behaving as a nucleophile in an SN1 reaction. Recall that if we do an SN1, we're going to get a racemic mixture. So there's the two enantiomers. That's the main takeaway. We want to understand that nucleophilicity parallels basicity. Now, the halides are going to be very common nucleophiles as well as leaving groups, so we want to understand how those behave. So in a polar aprotic solvent, meaning the solvent does not have any protons that are available for dipole-dipole interactions, it is going to be the case that that fluorine, or I should say fluoride, let's make these all the anions, the fluoride is going to be the strongest nucleophile because it is the strongest base of the halide ions. So the reason for that is that as you go down the periodic table, as you go down the halogens, the ionic radius is getting larger as we go. And if we have a larger ion, then that becomes more polarizable. So what that means is that it's a larger volume with which that ion can diffuse and spread apart, spread out its negative charge. So because the negative charge on the fluoride is highly localized on a very small ion, that makes it a very strong nucleophile. Now, all the halide ions are good nucleophiles, but in a polar aprotic solvent, it's going to be fluoride that's the best. Now, if you're looking at a polar protic solvent, this trend is going to reverse because by the same token, if the fluoride is much more basic, that means that it's going to spend the most time in solvent interacting with any available protons, let's say the protons on a water molecule. So we can see here, so water is a polar protic solvent, right? Because these protons are available for ion-dipole interactions. So this is an ion-dipole interaction, and there are several that the fluoride ion is able to participate in because it has a very localized charge. So because the fluoride ion is spending much more time interacting with molecules of solvent, that is going to hinder its ability to act as a nucleophile. Whereas it still will be able to, but in this case, the iodide is going to be the best because its charge is more spread out, it's more diffuse, it's more polarizable, so it is going to be spending less time participating in interactions with molecules of solvent, which will make it the best nucleophile of those. So leaving group ability is basically the opposite side of the coin. So it's precisely for the same reason that hydroxide is a very, very strong nucleophile. That's the same reason why it's a terrible leaving group. So hydroxide is very basic, it's unstable, it seeks to coordinate to something. So it should follow that if it's such a good nucleophile, then it's not really going to be in a rush to leave. So that's why a hydroxyl group is going to be a bad leaving group because it's so basic. Now, however, if we tack on another proton and make that a water molecule, water is a very good leaving group because a water molecule will be very stable once it has left. So that's why the halides as well are very good leaving groups because bromide is perfectly happy on its own. It's got a full octet, so that's not going to be a problem. And we can look at the same rules with which we examined the nucleophilicity of the halides to examine which ones are going to be the best leaving groups because we can see, depending on whether it's a polar protic or aprotic solvent, we'll know how well it is going to interact with the protons in solvent. So, but those are all going to be pretty good leaving groups. A third thing that we want to look at is the steric hindrance associated with the nucleophile. So let's take a look at these, the hydroxide and some alkoxides. So these all have O minus as trying to behave as a nucleophile. So we have roughly the same basicity. There's a small variation, but it's all O minus. So there's not much difference in the basicity here. So technically the nucleophilic strength is roughly the same. However, look at what's happening as we are adding more and more carbons branching. This is increasing the steric hindrance of the nucleophile. And there is a point where a nucleophile will no longer be able to approach a substrate because of all the steric hindrance. And so hydroxide being very small is able to approach even a a secondary system with some beta branching. It doesn't really matter. It's quite small. However, tert butoxide is the classic E2 promoter because it is simply too sterically hindered to approach the substrate and substitute. So the more sterically hindered the base, the less likely it is to substitute and the more likely it is to eliminate. The last thing we want to look at is temperature. So let's take a system like this. We've got a secondary haloalkane. We've got hydroxide. Hydroxide is very strong. We know we're probably looking at SN2 or E2. But we can look at temperature to choose which one is going to occur. So let's take two hypothetical temperatures. Let's call 0 a cold temperature, and 100 is going to be our hot temperature. So it, as it turns out, cold temperatures favor substitution, so at zero it's much more likely to get the SN2 product, and hot temperatures favor elimination, so at 100 we're much more likely to get one of the two possible elimination products. Now, the reason for this lies in the Gibbs free energy equation. So hopefully we remember this from Gen Chem. So delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. So delta G is the term it's Gibbs free energy. It refers to the spontaneity of any given reaction. So a negative value for delta G means it's going to be a spontaneous reaction. Positive will be non-spontaneous. Delta H is the change in enthalpy. So that's basically energy, the energy that's associated with the change in the reaction. And then T is temperature. Delta S is the change in entropy or disorder. So what one thing we need to understand is that an elimination reaction is more entropically favorable than a substitution reaction. And here's why. We have a substrate and we have a nucleophile. We have the product and the leaving group. So that's two molecules or atoms generating two things. So two things, two things. However, with an elimination, so we have the same setup at the start here, but look what happens at the end. We have the product, we have a water molecule, and a bromide. So two things become three things. More disorder, that's entropically favorable. Now the thing about the equation is that the change in entropy is being multiplied by temperature. So that means that at very high temperatures, the entropic favorability or unfavorability becomes a greater factor in determining the spontaneity of the reaction. So let's say we have a very entropically favorable situation like an elimination. At a high temperature, this whole T delta S term becomes more significant, and it becomes more likely that delta G is going to end up having a negative value. So that's why at high temperatures, elimination is going to be favored. So it can be tricky to choose which mechanism is occurring, but as long as we look at the substrate and the nucleophile, we ought to be able to eliminate some options. So let's put it all together and look at some examples. If we're going to look at something like this, so the first thing we can do is look at the substrate and see if we can eliminate any of the possible mechanisms. So this is a primary haloalkane. So immediately we can get rid of SN1 and E1. We're not going to form that primary carbocation. SN1 and E1 both require a carbocation intermediate to occur. So we're going to get rid of those options. We know it's going to be SN2 or E2. Likewise, if we look at the strength of the base, that's a strong base. It's a strong nucleophile. It doesn't have to wait for a carbocation to occur. It can bully around a substrate and make a reaction happen. So by that reasoning, again, we're looking at SN2 or E2. So we've just gotten rid of half of the options, and now we're down to SN2 and E2, just from looking at substrate and the base. So between SN2 and E2, we might have to look at maybe a temperature. Let's say we're doing this at 100 degrees. That is going to cause us to favor E2 because hot temperatures favor elimination. So number one, we're going to go with that as our E2 product. Okay. So number two, same setup, right? Both by looking at the substrate and the base, both of those things are telling us that we're looking at SN2 or E2 again. Now we're looking at the cold temperature. This time, maybe we're gonna favor some SN2. So number two, we're looking at that as our most likely product, SN2. So again, we're looking at the substrate, we're looking at the strength of the base, and we're looking at the temperature. That's going to allow us to figure out what's going on. So let's look at this one. Now we have a secondary substrate. So with the secondary haloalkane, we're not really going to be able to figure out too much about which reaction or which mechanism is going to occur. But we're looking at water as the nucleophile. So water is a weak base, so it is a poor nucleophile. That means we can get rid of SN2 and E2 as possibilities because it's not a strong enough nucleophile to do either of those reactions, either of those mechanisms. So we know we're going to get SN1 or E1, okay? Now, between the two, we can look at the temperature again. This time, let's say zero. So that means we're going to favor SN1 because colder temperatures favor substitutions. So we know that we're going to be looking at this, and that is our SN1 product. Okay, so once again, we're just looking at the base, and we're seeing that that is weak. That is a weak nucleophile, and a weak nucleophile will not be able to do SN2 or E2. So we're getting rid of those possibilities, and then we look to the temperature. So how about this? We've got the same substrate. Now we've got that tert butoxide. So if we remember from before, tert butoxide is the classic E2 promoter. Now the reason for this is it is strong. It is an alkoxide. It has a formal negative charge. So alkoxides are strong bases. So a strong base is a strong nucleophile. So it's going to be able to do SN2 or E2. It does not need to wait for a carbocation. It's gonna make something happen. It sees the substrate and it's either gonna try to coordinate or is gonna do an acid-base reaction because it's a strong base. Now the thing is that, remember before we were talking about steric hindrance of the nucleophile, there is too much steric hindrance associated with this nucleophile for it to coordinate. It cannot do SN2. So this can only do E2. So there is our E2 product. Okay, so remember, tert butoxide, always gonna go E2. So now let's look at a tertiary haloalkane. So with the tertiary, we can remember we're not gonna be able to do SN2. So we're getting rid of that possibility. Now the thing is, hydroxide is strong. Hydroxide is a strong base, so it's a strong nucleophile, so it's able to do SN2 or E2. It doesn't need to wait for a carbocation to form, so SN1 and E1 aren't gonna happen. That's just gonna take too long. Hydroxide finds a substrate in solution, it's gonna bully it around, it's gonna do something. But we just said it can't do SN2. So the only possibility is therefore E2. We don't even have to look to a temperature. We're seeing that this is gonna wanna either substitute or eliminate. It cannot substitute because of the steric hindrance associated with the substrate this time. So that is gonna give us an E2 product. So number 5, we added a carbon this time, so there's that. So there is our E2 product, incapable of doing SN2. Now, same substrate, now we're looking at methanol. Now, so methanol is weak, right? There is no formal charge there. It is comparable to water in terms of basicity. It just has that extra methyl group instead of a hydrogen, but it's completely covalent. There's no, it's neutral. There's no negative charge. So that is a weak base. So it is a poor nucleophile. So it is not strong enough to do SN2 or E2. So it's gonna be SN1 or E1. We're gonna look at the temperature, 100 degrees. Once again, that favors elimination. So, but it is weak, so it's gonna do E1. So it has to wait for that bromine to leave. Once that bromine leaves and we have the carbocation, then those beta protons become much, much more acidic, such that even a weak base like methanol is gonna be able to extract one. So let's say number 6 is our E1 product. Okay, so here's a few examples, and we were able to see how each mechanism could be promoted in certain situations depending on the substitution on the substrate, the strength of the base or nucleophile, and the temperature. So as long as you just think critically about any example you're given, you can always look to something like this and begin to get rid of something, whatever's going on, and narrow it down to the answer. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.